in the southern area around the Clavering area. It's about 45 minutes while the road is in through the Underlay Hills, then follow the seaside scenery. Certainly not sort of scenery we're going to see today. Our scenery will be mountainous for a large percentage of the journey, and quite spectacular rupture as well. We're only on the southbound main track line here for a few more minutes. We actually take a right-hand turn and cross and leave it there and head on to the middle of the line, quite a separate line from the rest of the main track here at the south end. Give you more information about the 25 shortly. Guessing how this part of the river got its name. This is Horseshoe Bend for fairly obvious reasons. Huge hook in the river there. If you look carefully, you'll see the river is actually cutting its way into that promontory or peninsula that sticks out of the river. Eventually it'll cut its way through there, changing the course. Steam trains for the rest of the journey
by Horsetown Coach of the Cobham Co Company over to Greymouth for Tokyo Tokyo. So there was quite a large station on the far side of here. Open up in time for the Great Exhibition in Christchurch. And one of the highlights of that exhibition was to take the South Pipe up the railway. It was considered a engineering marvel of the day. Took another 4 years to extend the line through. Fences on those photos for, they're not there to give you a migraine when you get the sunshine going.
Lake Sarah completely in shadow. The sun does not get over the top of Sugar Loaf Mountain there to our right for an excellent fishing lake. Rostock and brown trout also supports a large amount of waterfowl, including a huge flock of lake swans.
Floated across on barges from the far side of the pier, chipped out by a rudimentary private railway that ran from here back towards Greymouth. A lot of the timber was used in the coal mining industry for stays, etc., in the mines. When the easily millable timber ran out in the 1960s, arguably in New Zealand, although most of the trout seemed to still die of old age. Thank you.
but as long as the train doesn't come and we're halfway across, we'll be sweet. This bridge, there is the alternative route, which is north of Greymouth through Stillwater around Lake Brunner. It comes out at Kamara, and the junction is just down the road here. We'll go through it very shortly. This is the starting point to one of our multi-events. Joseph Glacier at a distance this afternoon. So here across the one-way bridge, if you're looking out towards your left, you'll see a camel's hump, and the top of it is up the top round to your left. So just above the tree line in the bottom of the valley is the glacier. Swimming pools are out in the bush, so you've just got a canvas cover over top. They're open until about 9:30 at night.
So, Wetter ist so schlecht, so viel Regen, also kein Helikopterflug möglich. Also umdisponiert, jetzt geht's zum Hiken. Ganzer Tag Wandern im Eis. Schauen wir mal. Tschö.
See the face of it. Mount Cook just up there to the left. If it's the Cloud Piercer. Thank you. to the left here is a river. These are power poles that my wife's taken the mickey out of me.
Thank you. come here when it's hot and sunny and stay in the camping grounds, holiday homes, enjoy the nice summer weather.
Over 80 kilometres long, long, narrow, very deep lake in the shape of an elongated S. And Queenstown is situated about halfway along the lake. Queenstown's got a residential population around about 18 to 20,000 people. It's not a huge town, but it's a very spread out place now. And around the lake edge, out with the rural area. Spread out. The central part of Queenstown is nice and compact in around traveling at Newman's Lee.
300 millimetres or a foot in 100 years. So some of those shrubs are really quite old. So the Real Journeys office is just here on our left. That's where we're going to stop. Pop-in cafe diagonally across the road to our right and ahead of us. Bathroom facility. Alley, flat bottom with steep sides. Now during the winter there's usually a considerable amount of snow on the mountains through here, and periodically it will find its way down to the valley floor, but most of the snow in this valley tends to disappear during the summer. Okay. A fire occurred in here and it was probably caused by lightning. Burned the forest to the ground, and that allowed cold air currents and frost to come into this area, and the cold conditions inhibited the regrowth of the native forest, leaving us with this wide open grass.
Wow.
Now you don't have to do the walk if you don't want to, it's up to you, it's entirely voluntary. And around 10 minutes after we leave the Murray Lakes, which is about 20 minutes from now, we were stopping off at a place called Knobs Flat. There are bathroom facilities there in case anybody's wondering. of how deep the ice was that came through here. Have a look at these mountains on the left-hand side of the valley, and then when we get up past these trees, have a look out to the right, and you'll see that the mountains on the right are much shorter, smoother and rounder. And the reason for that is the ice from the glacier actually pushed out over the top of these right-hand mountains, wore them away and smoothed them off, but it couldn't get out over the top of the mountains on the other side. But you can see the steep sheer faces there with the beech forest clinging onto it. They were all carved out by ice. Now it's a cooperative effort among all of the plants that allows that beech forest to grow up there on those steep sheer faces.
Coming up. Ready. Ready. Egg. Fire. Ooh. Ooh, nice glacier.
Hi. Then to the left of, and we cannot see the top of it from the road. We'll make our way down into the base of this valley.
No, not really. Not to me. There's too much foliage color. Too much.
Imagine this place on a reel and may be lingering in it. And cold. It's warmer here than it was in Tiana. It was only 3 in Tiana. Now we're going to cross it in place on the road. And what they do is they fly into the catchment areas where the snow builds up. They fly in with helicopters. And they drop out explosive charges, and this sets off mini avalanches, and it stops the snow from building up to a level. Nevertheless, it is. Glacial valleys open out into this wide round bowl-shaped amphitheater. That was where the snow was collected and compressed into ice and that went on to form the small glacier that came out of that valley to our right and joined in with the main glacier which came down through. In the next 20 minutes or so, it started off that carved out Milford Sound, which of course means that it's not a sound at all. In place there are large avalanches that come down here. And it all becomes a no-stopping zone during avalanche season. And then quite often you see cars parked at the toes of the avalanches with mum and dad and the kids out playing on the snow. And so far we've gotten away with it. But one day it will all turn to There's usually one here every season. This was an exceptionally large one last season, and when they managed to get a track cut through it to open the road, the snow on either side of the road was twice the height of this coach. You can see glacial ice up here on the face of Mount Talbot up ahead of us. They stopped for the duration of World War II, and this tunnel was finally opened for road traffic in 1953. Now we're going to make a stop here. We'll be able to get out. Now you may notice a parrot floating around here. It's just out by this car at the moment. This is one of our native parrots, reliant on humans. The other thing is, this snow over here is really, really dangerous. That is a dangerous place to be. So we recommend that you don't go anywhere near it. There are signs down there telling people not to, and we can only reinforce those signs.
Icicles.
Do you want to get a couple, Miami? So you wouldn't want to stop in a hurry on this section of road today.
It's quite icy.
Got grit on it. Thank you. 46 metres. You can see the glacier on it.
What's the bridge on the right?
Sorry?
Bridge on the
left. Oh, the bridge, that's the old bridge. We sometimes stop here and walk out onto that, but they're redecking it at the moment, so we can't. Shh. From here, I've never driven over it, and quite frankly, I wouldn't want to, because it moves around when you walk on it. Goodness knows. Navigator is at the wharf now. That's the three masts you can see over there. That's for the nature cruise with the blue. Blue.
Make your way around the fjord on this beautiful afternoon. We'll be pointing out, we're doing most of that. He's your nature guide. He'll be joining you very shortly. He's on a very important errand at the moment, so he'll get here as soon as he can. He's making me a cup of tea. Oh, speak of the devil. The devil's arrived with no cup of tea. Anyway, while he's getting me a cup, I'll just tell you about that lovely big waterfall out there behind us, the Bowen Falls, and it drops 526 in the Darren and Cascade Ranges. We'll get another good look at the Bowen Falls, of course.
Creates what's known as a tree avalanche. It only takes one or two of those trees at the top of the hill to start falling, and because all the roots are interconnected, once that one tree starts falling, it'll start dragging all the other trees off as well. And they're very common in this part of the world, mainly because of the steepness of the countryside, the fact that we're in the roaring 40s here, and of course the fact that we do get a lot of earthquakes in this part of the world.
Oh, yes.
Underneath the Pacific tectonic plate. Now we're on the Pacific plate here, so everything you see around you is still being pushed up, it's still being uplifted. In fact, it's rising at the alarming rate of about what your fingernail grows, which puts these mountains along the west coast of the South Island, including Fjordland, in amongst the fastest growing mountains in the world. Of course, this is why we get so many earthquakes here as well. Of course, we won't go on too much about earthquakes. We do realise that for most of you to get home later on today, you're still going to have to drive home through that very long, dark, narrow little tunnel, of which I must say is a rather large and extremely heavy mountain. But good luck with that anyway. You might notice though, as we do approach St Anne's Point, the boat might just move up and down a little bit more. This is the Tasman Sea itself, so just be careful if you're wandering around the deck, especially if you're carrying tea and coffee with you. So that's up to them.
Yeah,
now these are bottlenose dolphins.
कितने सारे यहाँ पे नीचे भी देखो डॉल्फिन दिख रहे
Yes, I see them. Yes.
There.
Do they always swim in those larger pools?
ये इसकी ले लो ना फोटो
ले 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 ले
Just up here on the left side of the Wilford overhang. That's actually a 700 metre cliff, 2,100 feet up to the top there. And that is part of the vertical up the top. That is a granite veranda overhanging the whole mountain here, undercut by the glacier, causing the top part of that cliff to collapse onto the glacier to be carried out to sea. We actually know that happened because there's no debris down there beneath it. It's basically just straight down here to the bottom of the fjord. So this is what's officially known as the Wilford overhang. Slow the boat down a little bit, but you just notice on the water, but there you go, there's one, two, three of them there, quite hard to spot, but you can see them just sitting on the rocks there, and a few of them in the water too. This is, you'll see them lounging around there, sticking their flippers up in the air. It's the Wilford Sound synchronized swimming team, doing their practice routine. These are mainly young males of seals here in Wilford. We don't have a seal colony here. And they just come here to shelter from the open ocean and mainly stay away from those big, nasty, angry fish out there in the Tasman Sea with sharp teeth. And I'm talking about sharks here, of course. We do get a lot of shark off the coast here, mainly great whites and makos. Now they do tend to prey on these young seals. We are very lucky to still have the seals with us. They were just about hunted to extinction back in the 1800s. Sealers came from all around the world to specifically hunt those seals, the New Zealand fur seal. And the reason they did this was to turn them into hats. New Zealand fur seal has the second densest fur of any mammal after the sea otter, so they were in great demand. They are fully protected now, but it took a long time. They didn't become protected, or sealing didn't stop in this country until 1946, which was quite late on in the piece. They hunted at night, nocturnal feeders, and they tend to sit around on the rocks all day drying their coat out.
We've got a few mushrooms or toadstools.
Are still alive.
So this is the shortcut to mushrooms.
So did all the horses come from New Zealand, right?
They did, yeah. A lot of them were like thoroughbred sort of bees. This one and this one. So basically this whole area is just packed full. Yeah. Yeah, it's fairly tight sort of spot. So you're welcome to jump up there and recreate it. And then also in the background you see there's a few gum trees up there. So they added a bit of smoke in the background so you didn't get the Australian gum trees in the background. Yeah. Yeah. Fantastic. But yeah, this is where it all happened. It's amazing when you look around thinking it's right on the edge. He did a lot of the drawings for Tolkien, well not for Tolkien, but for the public. And so Peter Jackson decided he would be perfect to bring on in design of the film, because it basically it's been his whole life drawing the work. And the same went for another of the designers, John Howe.
It's probably cheaper to bring it all together like this than it is to go to where that is and then put everything together. It's just
one man with a camera then from
it doesn't work like this, well, with the one man in the camera.
They would even rebuild some of the spec in the studios as well. Fine. So a sound stage and that's the
Yes, you've seen them, right? It's not interesting.
Is that a little Santa?
That mum's eagle. Oh.
This is an old tree. This is an old tree. Must be.
These are the same trees that are on Mount Victoria. You know when they're up?
Yeah.
So these ones, they've had their full chance to sort of grow and do what they naturally do. Whereas the ones on Mount Vic, they've sort of been planted too close together. So that's sort of...
That's old.
It is, yeah. It's an image of this great big tower, and they had an actor riding his horse that they were living in. So they wanted that look of all of the mountains there. So there's sort of like a streak of dark green grass.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And it sort of comes out this slight line running all the way along.
Yeah.
So they built this road going in through there. Posts and chains all set up. And then all just the props and so on. Just the detail. Like a lot of this stuff, you didn't even see it in the movie at all. But they had so much detail that Tolkien had put into the books. So the props part of this movie. And that's the move.
Well, I mean, the theme is always the same, no? He helps the underdog and...
Would you like me to sort of pull up?
If you... What's this road called?
This is just basically the Miramar Coastal Road.
Okay.
Yeah. Just around this, they've got all this wide open space. It's really neat. The hills above us, it used to be like an old government defence base. So you had like gun emplacements set up here to protect the harbour.
Okay.
And an old prison. And when they were making King Kong,
yeah,
they used some of this hillside up here and built like the village for Skull Island.
Okay.
With all the natives running around. Yeah, really cool. Like just little quiet bays like this. Nothing at all in them. Good fishing around here as well.
Hmm.
And you're only sort of 5-10 minutes drive from the city centre.
Is
out and you get a little shot here of the hobbits arriving at Bree. And
I'd like to advise you that your buffet counter is now open. If you look in the centre pocket, there a poulet with a fresh yogurt on top that you can add some muesli to. If you're like me, you might just need some caffeine to give you a kickstart in the morning. We have a range of teas and coffees available. Buffet counters are located in carriage B, which is one bag from C, two forward from A, and one forward from Q.